Thank you, first of all, for the research. And actually, I think it's the task does this really well, and they call everybody the data and go to the stand and find out about the figures of the country. And I think these panels are also really research. It's public research. You know, it's research with all of you. And over the 2 days, we circled back for some topics and some ideas and some IDs and see, okay, how does this work in damage? These operators. Now we're going to talk about CPEs, what next generation CPE, customer premises equipment for broadband operators. And we have people here that have to take these decisions. Now let's first do a quick round of what decisions are you taking right now? What do you have? What's coming? First, what do you have? Jeff, you have a big company under your hood.
Well, it's not my company. well, we are obviously different types of CPEs across our different geographies. By the way, obviously, as we are operating in 17 countries of Africa, I can imagine that what we are deploying in Africa is not exactly the same thing that we are deploying in more advanced market, like the French market or some of other European markets.
If you say that, if it's not the same, does that mean it's all the material, or what's the difference?
The difference is that obviously the RPUs are not exactly the same, so the cost of the CPEs might be different, so we'll end up working maybe with different suppliers. The development maturity obviously are very broad in Africa, if not the one that we have in Europe, so also the kind of phasing of deployment is not exactly the same, so you have to take into consideration pricing, relationship with the manufacturers, the technologies. This is based on the maturity of the markets.
Yeah. And bring it back to Europe, what do you have in CPEs? What's their
requirement? We talked yesterday about Wi-Fi, so Wi-Fi is a big thing. The one topic that we are now targeting and addressing very seriously here, which relates to environmental aspects. As a company, we announced our goal to be net carbon 2040, so 10 years in the next compared to the kind of GSCA commitments.
2040,
absolutely. Yeah, we have some yes and no. The gap is really important to get there. So for CPEs, we do represent not a significant but a serious element in terms of the global equation for what we call scope 3.
Okay, so we'll come back to the environmental
So we do a lot of things around that, which is about the input design, recycling, energy consumption. So this is one of the big things that we are addressing, and this would not have been the case maybe 5 years ago.
And we'll also come back to the standards. So I'm curious for all of you at the very standards, but if you're also moving to Wi-Fi 7, for instance.
In Wi-Fi 7, we launched Wi-Fi 6, it was actually on the slide last year in France, so it was back in April 2022. Wi-Fi 7 is coming, so obviously the technology is not completely mature or dry as we say in our language. So at some point in time, obviously, we'll be looking at it, but right now we don't have any coming. And when we have launched, when you have launched a new CPE, obviously you have a certain time before you launch a new one. So
it's not like that.
So what I can say is that in Deutsche Telekom, we started pretty much 4 years ago a kind of harmonization also on our portfolio. So if you look at the footprint, so since it's orange, we have in Europe 9 markets that we are responsible for. So we're talking about more than 19 million broadband customers. And in here what we have was pretty much a huge fragmentation when it comes to the devices, the manufacturers, the software platforms, the service partners, even the technology. So we have pretty much all the access technologies around the footprint, and we had to start to work on a convergence plan. So 4 years ago, this was the strategy that we take, which is, first of all, to harmonize our product portfolio, to make sure that we have a product catalog that can indeed serve our future needs, to add new service on top of it, to make sure that our customers could identify well with the brand, because this is also an important step. And therefore, we are also very proud that in the past years, we were able to make make sure that all our footprint in Deutsche Telekom is now covered with Wi-Fi 6. So this was a huge effort.
So internal standards, just make sure it's not all
this. As you can imagine, so we started with all the different, and we had different panels discussing about this. We have fiber, DSL, XGS-PON, we have DOCSIS, 3.2, 3.1, so we have pretty much everything, and we had to take a decision to really start working on the convergence map. So we started with this new broad portfolio. Now we are Wi-Fi 6 in all the markets with our own products.
So you also don't
put outside suppliers, you have to work. We do work with our partners, so the same brands that you could share there. But right now we are working with them in a more centralized manner, meaning that instead of us having like what we had before, which was pretty much 18 different suppliers across the globe, we now have specific partners, specific brands with whom we are working with. And again, this allowed us to be much more, I would say, structured also on the target.
Does it also mean, and we'll come back to this, does it mean to you the right specifications and then they will build for you instead of you go around in the market and buy yourself?
So, that's one of the principles, and we went one step further too. So not only now we are pretty much working from a specification base, but now we also took the decision to do our own internal development. And so this was an important step, like what Chen was saying, that there is partners like Softit.com with whom Orange is working on. On our case, on PT, we took the decision to start doing for specific areas our own internal. So we have teams prepared for the development of the software for the CPEs, but also for other areas, such as what we call our One App, which is pretty much the application that we serve for digital touch point across all the markets. So this is once again one entry point for our customers to be able to identify with the brand and to get full access.
It's a logical issue. Lots of markets together in one standardized.
It's the only way. So if you look at
not always what you want to find, but for yeah.
Yes. It's definitely one important step because again, when you talk about being responsible for 9 markets, knowing that each market has its own complexity, you need to start creating a strategy that allows you also to be much more productive, even for the markets itself.
They will find.
It will be a win-win solution for all.
Life change, less consumers never like change. Christian, tell us what you do, because you are a little bit of a different role in this.
Sure, yes. Yeah. So I'm Christian, I'm the managing director for Heinz Telekom. Heinz Telekom is a company that exists since 2008. And we are really a Broadcom house, so we have done since 2008, so since 15 years now. It's developed software for service providers. So what we do is a high quality gateway, let's say. And now what we're really doing is expanding internationally. So we are based in Geneva, Switzerland. We have R&D in Israel, where we do software development. And manufacturing happens in China for the European market. And then we also serve, you know, Latin America and the US. But, you know,
so your clients are the operators, and what exactly do you divide? Is it just software or software?
No, what we do is hardware and software. So we do CPEs, we do home gateways and Wi-Fi extenders. And we see a big opportunity for a company like ours because the houses are evolving really. And our opportunity really is for service providers that needs to differentiate. Means that those gateways cannot just be a platform that provides connectivity to the internet and single Wi-Fi. It really becomes a hub for multiple services. I mean,
yeah, we absolutely want to discuss that because it's a changing.
Yes.
Well, it could be changing. It's not sure.
Yes, and also I agree with James was saying. I think that energy will become a very important topic. So I think there is a need for the CPEs to become more intelligent in the way we manage bands, in the way we actually, especially starting with not only the gateway but extenders. You know, living in a big house, and when I look at how much energy we consume as a household, just broadcasting Wi-Fi all day long, every day of the year, it would make a lot of sense for the gateway and the extenders to have some sort of intelligence, not only, you know, to do band, shut down certain bands that might not be required, but also why not shut down extenders if there is no traffic going on. So there is a lot of innovation. innovation that we're going to see over the next coming months, coming years, let's say.
Very good. We'll talk about that innovation specifically. Tomas, what is your role? I would say Auto is a little bit different than what it was before, right? It's more independent.
So my role, I'm working for Auto Czech Republic on the position that I'm responsible for the things and ICT services. Of course, CPE is bottom part of the services. We talk mainly about B2C, but as well for B2B, of course. We as a company are quite strong on the fixed services, but part of the fixed services as well is fixed wireless access for us, as my colleague mentioned yesterday here. And from the CPE perspective, we are looking for to have the unique line of the CPE across all the technologies. So give customers switch between the technology depending on the bandwidth, services, etc., to have the same experience. On the features of the CPE, we look mainly really strongly customer-centric. So we try to give, we measure as well something we call CEM, customer experience management. So we try to make it as much friendly, because in fact the CPE is only the part of the network on our service which is taking its own.
And if you say customer-friendly, I think customers, in principle, would have to pick up a phone call and have somebody come around and fix it. That's super customer-friendly, but financially the worst.
Exactly. So the part of the payment is an example. So if there is a problem on the service, it means service end-to-end, not even on our network CP, but as well on his home Wi-Fi. Usually 70% of the calls are due to the Wi-Fi. We should know that prior that the customer knows that. Because from the CP you can download, if the CP is manageable and nice and manageable, a lot of information. So if customer is calling, for example, you can load it directly if there is outage. Or if we see that network isn't working correctly, we can help him because we have basic information even about his home network, Wi-Fi, how he's connected, etc. And all this information are coming from a CP, so the manageability of CP and intelligence of CP is very important. So we have did a couple of good features which we see which help the first line guys to manage the CP. So every single CP which we have on the network has IPERF measurement embedded. So we know which is really the bandwidth which the customer has, so we claim that it doesn't
have to be nice touch upon what we're going to discuss in a minute, that from a distance, being aware of what's going on because of the intelligence in those CPEs also means you can start to run a little past the lives, the internet lives of your customers, which also means you can move to more to smarter services and more services. We'll discuss those in a second. Let's first meet our last guest in this panel. Tell us, what is your role?
Whatever, let's say, products or services United Group wishes to launch, it goes through our hands. And
United Group is a really big group in Central Eastern Europe, and you have your complete tech stack yourself, right?
Yes.
Everything yourself, hardware, software, everything.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So we started in 2016, and we forayed into OTT first, and we have the complete in-house development of the entire technology stack for the OTT. Streamers, transcoders, servers, mobile applications, set-top boxes, everything. And then we, together with United Group, we also quite aggressively expanded. United Cloud is currently 350 people, majority of which are basically engineers, software developers, etc. And in, fairly recent times, we're also going into the, I think that we all here are trying to crunch the exact same nut and
same problem.
Exactly, but the way that we are trying to tackle this is, we try to have the same, basically the same operating system, right? We have opted to base it out of OpenWRT, and we have currently we're about to get in production of a successful POC for DOCSIS, but we're slowly and surely expanding the footprint with basically a singular goal that, you know, that any, because we do have the internal know-how for developing the, let's say, or integrating perhaps the smart services, right? Well, by using this technology, you know, we can develop it once and deploy it everywhere, which is a big, big advantage.
Yeah, and then you can develop this for the United Group, but it's basically a spin-off that now also can work for others, right? You offer your services not only to the United Group, but more than that.
So, regarding the broadband CPE, so United not currently offers services only for United.
Okay, so no. Yeah.
But we are, let's say, fully booked.
It's individual CEO last year. You suggested that it's more open than you.
Yeah.
It's 350 people for this whole big group, and we do everything.
Yeah.
All right. Now, this is just a round of introductions. And we have, let's say, 40 minutes left. So I want to focus on what is new, what is happening now, and what that could mean for the future. And as said, it's public research. Want to ask questions, don't wait till the very, very last minute. So, any questions already? Then we'll start. But then do feel free to come up with additional questions. First of all, maybe, and let's do that quickly, because I think a lot of people understand what is possible now. But nevertheless, what are the innovations when it comes to these CPE devices that are appealing to the customers and that also sort of can justify developing this further? I mean, some of them might be in existence, some of them might be in pilot phase, some of them might be under development, but what are the innovations you guys feel this is something that our customers will like? Who wants to go first?
Yeah.
There you go.
So, 2 years ago, we the product called Connect, which is a mobile application which basically serves as a self-care mechanism for broadband CPEs, and is tightly integrated also with the logic on the CPE, on the CPEs themselves. What this does is, you know, you can, okay, through the application you can manage your Wi-Fi, you can change your password, which is all good, right? But the let's say value-added functionality for us was the parental control. We have implemented a sort of visual set on the broadband CPE which identifies the local clients and then translates the DNS requests and enriches them, etc. etc. I won't bore you too much with the technical details, but the idea is that we can then implement a certain set of conditions per device within the household, right? And have the household manager, right, the parent, let's say,
yeah.
Manages through a very, let's say, intuitive application. This has been quite well received, right?
And if you talk about parental control, that itself can also cover a whole range of things. Is that basically, well, let's say, a set of pornography and stuff you don't
It's,
or are there also other controls? I mean,
so you have in our case you have adult restrictions, then you have anti-spam, then you have gambling, etc. etc. There's a lot of, I think we are partners with Whalebone.
So they monitor what sets we need to block.
No, they just offer us the database, right?
Yeah.
And then we have the implementation on our side.
Yeah, but it's changing databases.
We're constantly updating.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, fully agree. I think there are two things which we develop and which customers really needed, even they didn't know some of them. First is that manageability. So we have an application for our premium. And it's mainly for the Wi-Fi management. Yeah, 70% of the calls which you have are not the problems of the network, but on the Wi-Fi. Overloaded Wi-Fi from the local flats, badly set Wi-Fi. One device which is wrong at home can disturb all the services around in the same Wi-Fi hotspot, etc. So that's first fix. And generally, our CEO said, don't deploy the network for me or for the geeks. We deploy for the massive usage. Or the people which don't repair their car, they don't repair their watch machine, etc. So they want to repair their modem, slot, etc. So we need to be nice.
That's really quality control.
Yeah. And the second thing, and that's important as well, we call it the security features. Yeah. Security means protect kids, but protect as well against the attacks on the network side. So we use, by the way, as well, Valmon for the basic services. We develop more and more. It's not only about the CPE, it's about the whole ecosystem. A CPE play a very important role, because without CPE it's much more complicated. So if there is a good CPE, it's a good starter for the security service, which are very important.
Is it also something like, not just parental control in the sense like, okay, this is content you can't use, but also like these two devices in the household are for those people working from home, and they have preference on benefit any time over everybody who's gaming or doing that. So is that something that's, I can imagine after Corona, with everybody working from home, you want a sort of a division there, jammed up.
Yeah, you are, we are looking at that, but as you said rightly, you don't have to make it too complex, because as you get into that, then you are like, okay, should I prioritize my device, by user and device, by time, so you get into very quickly into complexity. So we have to make it simple, otherwise people will simply not use it. But before also commenting on your question, I would like just to make a statement. Usually there is this kind of tendency to think that telcos have not been really innovating in the past years. I really oppose that, because we have been able to make tremendous increases in terms of usage and bandwidth consumption, adding tens and tens of devices in the household, and this is, I think, a huge thing. And we tend to forget that we are also doing a lot of
innovation.
Technology. The beauty of it is that
What is Wi-Fi sensing? Explain it.
So basically, you are using the Wi-Fi waves propagation. Think about the kind of radar time technology. So you use the Wi-Fi waves propagation, and you can identify patterns. And if you basically see a certain pattern, you are able to state whether or not there is someone or something in the room.
So what is it? So there's Wi-Fi all over the house, and
you can just use the existing equipment. That's the beauty of it. You don't need to add new equipment. Basically, you need two Wi-Fi equipments to be simple in a certain place, and based on the waves propagation, you can identify where or not there is someone in the room.
So
then you get into how efficient can it be, how granular can it be. So the basic case is there is someone, there is no one. You can do some kind of pet filtering, so at least you know that this is a human being and not a cat or a dog. Then whether or not the people are moving, then whether or not potentially you will be falling. So a number of people are trying to see whether or not at some point in time you would apply that to kind of people falling and elder care.
Yeah.
But obviously the technology has to be a little bit more mature, I think, to be really able to get into these cases. The first one is really there is someone, there is no one, which can then apply to all security. You are far away and there is someone, that means that there is something wrong. Or you're expecting your kids to be at home and it's 7 p.m. there's still no one, and you just get...
It's 4 at night, yes, there's still no one.
Sometimes I'm talking with some people in the advertising space, if you maybe think 5 years from now, you could identify whether or not it's running in front of the TV set, and then when you switch on the TV set, what you see is basically advertising which is targeted to you, or your profile, you just get the networks that you are very...
But of course, that's also a territory where, at least my TV set, you can switch on your choose your profile, and so there's also from that side. Wi-Fi sensing seems to be really only with the people that have these boxes in the house, right? Nobody else can do that.
And again, the beauty of it is that at least for most of our equipment, we can use the existing equipment. So we are not asking people to bring a new equipment in the house, which has a benefit from an economic standpoint, from an environmental standpoint, so that's the interesting thing.
And this is you describe it as something that could be done? Is it already being done?
We have projects.
Ah, okay. Well, I have a prime target here. My 83-year-old mother-in-law lives with us. He would like to know she's moving around and not still too long. And my 16-year-old is out and out in Amsterdam these days, night and day. So, you know, we're definitely want to go ahead.
Listening to what the colleagues are saying is so spot on, and it's aligned with what we're seeing in the industry. It's the home, the city in the home is becoming a hub for all these services. But the question is, and I think Chen touched this point, yes, I was listening to his presentation, and he said there is no clear up that we actually be, yeah, we need to have this and that. I think it's still, clearly Wi-Fi management is required, and everybody's going in that direction. But then it's going to be energy management, it's going to be Wi-Fi sensing, parental control is something that is, you know, fairly common nowadays. I think there will be a wide range of applications and services that will be available.
Okay, so just to pick up on that, so we have now parental control, just smart Wi-Fi, just making sure it works. We have Wi-Fi sensing, which is all kind of privacy questions, but sounds like a super promising thing because nobody else can offer it, only because that has a doctor. What other services?
What I'm trying to say is, I don't think that as an industry, there are plenty of services. I don't think we can really say this is the clear app for the future. But what I'm trying to bring to the point that I'm trying to bring, and this is probably an area of interest, is that if you make some analogies between the CPEs today and what I think the CPEs will evolve into the future, they're very monolithic today. So that means that the CPE runs a piece of software which is very similar to all the houses. That means that whatever features as a CSP you decide to have, it will actually get deployed throughout all the houses. And you can compare that with mobile phones. You know, 15 years ago, before iPhone, we used to buy a phone and make phone calls, SMS, and we're all happy. But I do believe that CPEs will evolve in the direction of the mobile phones that we have today. And then that will give the CSP an opportunity really to have, yes, common applications that will be connectivity to the WAN, the Wi-Fi management, maybe the parental control, everybody will have that. But then there will be an opportunity as well to have a portal, we will to define that, but the services that can be offered, like Jen was referring as Wi-Fi sensing, but that could be an opportunity to increase ARPU, because at the end of the day, we are all suffering, you know, the game has been around, I give you more throughput, I give you lower prices, but that's not sustainable. We need as an industry to come up with new and innovative ways to maintain that or try to increase that ARPU.
And that model, undoubtedly, is being developed by other players as well. Is Deutsche Telekom looking at this? Because so, you have a big region.
Yeah, I was going to say that, first of all, I fully agree with what people are saying here. I think that we're all facing the same challenge independently of which operator it is. But I think that we need to take one step back. So first of all, many of these features that we're talking here, if the majority of our customers do not even know how to interact with the device, unless we really change the way that our customers are interfacing with these functionalities, this will not generate any kind of engagement or any kind of profit for them, right? The reality is that the majority of our customers today have a device at home. None of them access their local device, none of them access their configuration. They leave it as it is, and they just pray that the device will not break and the connectivity will become stable. But this is what we need to change, and this is where we start to change, which is creating this, people call it the killer app. So for me, creating this whole customer experience, this whole customer engagement that we're doing it, this is the killer app. Making sure that we have a digital touch point for people to go to. If they want to know more about their networks, if they want to know more about future promotions, if they want to know more about their contract. So this is what we are able to provide to them. Making sure that they can feel safe, can feel secure through this digital touch point. Now, of course, once you are able to get this, you can start working on an add-on service, elevated service, like we're doing with AirTice, the partner that is here today, which is definitely an important partner for us when it comes to Wi-Fi management solutions. This is one important part of the strategy. But again, we should not also minimize the impact that it is about how we are interfacing with the customers. And right now, even service line Wi-Fi sensing, with full respect of what Orange is doing, the reality is that we understand the use case, we understand the potential for it, but we have other basic things to fix first.
Yeah. And as I mentioned, there's others moving into the territory as well, of course. I mean, maybe it's good to briefly discuss the new standards like Meta for smartphones, which right now is, I mean, this is a big thing, and it's with Amazon and Apple and Google and IKEA, you know, Samsung, UI. They're all working on having an open standard for home appliances that can connect to a smart home hub. Who will own it? And right now it's already passed last year for lighting and locks, but they're working on energy systems and Wi-Fi, smart Wi-Fi, so all coming up. So there's new standards and there's new really big players that want to be the owner of the hub in the house. That is not this set at all, but a completely different set of huge companies. So how, any response to that? Is this something you are looking at and saying, okay, I'll go there, I'll take that around, I'll be that platform?
So we are looking at it, going back to what Pedro said, we have to make the basic square right before thinking about other stuff. So when it comes to Meta and smart home, I think there were huge expectations about smart home in the past years, and I think globally,
very disappointing so far.
Globally, it's not only about telcos, it was not as successful as people would have expected, or the industry would have expected. Part of the reason is fragmentation, different standards, technologies, different companies, or my bulb is from company A, and my bulb is from company B, and when I'm trying to make that work together, it's not working. So the promise of Meta is really to make all that interoperable and make it simple. So that's the promise. Again, people don't care about standards, non-standards, they just want it to work. So we have to kind of hide the complexity and make sure that it's going to work. So what's new? The big tech guys are really pushing on, and you have also a lot of the kind of appliances manufacturers, etc., which are promoting the standard. So we are obviously part of the standardization movement and looking at it. Then I think, if Pedro and the other colleagues would agree, what would be the case for network operators in this new ecosystem? This is still something that needs to be sorted out. So we are following, we are pushing, we are participating. Now again, what would be our role in the value chain? I think the answer is not finding it.
It's not clear, it will be a new constellation.
That is exactly the point that I wanted to touch. I think that, that the important thing, but if it exists, but then there is no role for the CSP, you know, fine, you know, that's really touches. But what we, at least from a Heinz perspective, what we are trying to promote, what we think is going to happen, we're building all our gateways 16 and 7 now with battery enabled chipsets. So it comes with a silicon lab chipset inside and it's able to support the three key networks, let's say, which is Zigbee, BLE, and Thread. So again, for us it's a bet because we have seen these many times. It's going to happen.
Yes.
But at least we are an innovation company. That might be an area of growth. So time will say if Matter is really successful. I do hope it is because I see big brands like you just said, IKEA. So perhaps if they produce these little devices, the opportunity for the CSP is to go and let people buy those devices, but then become the anchor point, have the central hub, the connectivity point in the gateway. So that becomes a more sticky conversation with the customer. That means that if you have a gateway that has that functionality in place, obviously you can go buy an Alexa app if you wanted to. That's what we all do today. You know, we go on Alexa, we buy the things, but we are technology people, so we're happy with that. But it's not scalable, it's not really the mass market. Yeah. So for me, the opportunity for CSPs is to have that functionality running in a platform that they control, which could well be a gateway.
Let me see
those
questions from the audience. Yes, please, there's one in fact. Because we have a little bit of topic, and I also want to touch again on the environmental issues as well, design issues, and anything else you want to bring up. So we have a lot to cover in a relatively short time. Go ahead.
Hi. We are talking a lot here about launching new innovations, introducing new CPEs to the clients, but I have a question in regards
by 2040, right? This again might sound like a lot of time, but I assure you
it is not. I know, but I know it is.
No, it isn't. And to touch upon this issue, you know, we currently are in the process of, you know, going into each and every detail of the entire operation, right? And one of the things is also, you know, the I'm currently talking about some future things, not, you know, current deployments, right? But it, you know, it it touches on, you know, all the packaging, the power consumption, etc. We are also investing, you know, in electricity plants, you know, water electricity plants, basically to generate electricity in a clean fashion, etc. So for today's operation, unfortunately, I don't have a response. I honestly don't know. But we are now deeply invested into getting to net zero.
And so you say you invest every step of the process, and also where you source your electricity, materials as well? Or?
So it's everything, you know. Okay, you can look at the CPE as a device that, you know, consumes some power, right? But you have to look also at, you know, each smart feature that we are talking about today, right? Is deployed in a private or a public cloud, which is very, very intensive on power consumption, right? So perhaps people are not so, you know, perhaps people don't see this, right? But each service that is, you know, outsourced to the cloud, okay, perhaps it does not generate the electricity bill at the customers, right?
Yeah.
But it's
some,
you know, service subscription, etc. So
would this mean that looking forward, you decide to have much more intelligence in the CPE rather than have the cloud based and everything going back?
So it has to be. So the entire stack has to be revamped from the CPE, right? Also to the, you know, just take a look at the fleet of the vehicles that you need to have to just support the operation, right? Just, you know, having a small, you know, savings in the fuel consumption, you know, just generates so much more positive impact, etc. So yeah, we have to take it basically at everything.
And you look at everything and then you sort of redesign the process to make it more efficient.
Yeah, that's why I said 2040 is not.
This was the first time I heard this, right? Not really, but it was a presentation by Olivia Lazar, a very smart woman, who explained how all the wearables we need across the world are leading to all kinds of geopolitical tensions and, you know, decisions, because there are in some areas, like in Africa and China, you know, if you start there, then we need to run our AI-based smart system across the world. Well, we are looking for a lot of problems. Go ahead.
I think small things started to be done, but there is a lot of work on that, because we see now there is a regulation which we need to follow. There are more and more requests from every side, our customers, on the business side even more, because that's today every single public tender or general big tenders, the number of questions for the environment protection is much more bigger than the number of questions about the network prices, etc. So we see this trend. So it will follow. There are small things which happened, and I would like to mention some of them. Yeah, we discuss cloud paperwork. We try to be paperless. That's first. Not only the packaging, but as well all the manuals, all this stuff through the smartphones, through the QR code, etc. It should help in the customer centric, and it helps with the environment. Yeah, and starting from these small points. Second thing is, I see statistics that mobile phone is changes for every 2 years, 3 years is a long term, because there is a lot of innovation. Well, sometimes the innovation are counterproductive. If we have the CPEs which work 6 years, twice at the same time, it's half of the CPE which must be produced, etc. So the development is great, but to develop the new functionalities which are not supported on the older equipment should be counterproductive from this part. So we need to look as well from this way. Which is great is that today we see that CPE generally has enough power, enough performance, enough good chipset to support not only the today's features but as well the futures. So we can change the features by new software development, etc. instead of change the hardware every single time. Again,
that significantly can in total.
And what you come to have to change the hardware, is that also attempt there to make it more modular or make it refurbishable?
It's outsourcing, so it's one thing that you can do is try to leverage the limited hardware capabilities of the Broadband CPE, push the data that you can to the cloud, whether be it on-prem, etc., and make the cloud heavy work for you.
Right. Yeah. And then you can upgrade this, right? Yeah. Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah. We are doing basically all what was said, from what we call eco design, because we process it. That means that from day one, you have to follow specific routes, and it takes a lot of time to train people to do that, etc. So we have a huge competencies challenge in our organization, because these are not obvious things to do. So. One key thing that I would like to highlight is the way you think about price when you purchase devices. I would say that the tendency would be to say let's go for the less expensive device. But with these environmental considerations, we really have to change that, because what we want is to extend the life of our devices as much as possible. Which means that you need to spend extra money when you purchase a device. That means more memory, more CPU, better materials, which might be, by the way, recycled plastic or by your source of buying materials. So in the end, your device is not going to last 3 years, but 6, 7, 10 years, and that you'll be able also to recycle the device several times, which we do. So it's kind of
10 years.
Yeah, we can get to 10 years. So, but again, that can happen if from day one you said, okay, it's going to be 10 years, so I need again memory that I don't need right now, but I might need in 6 years' time. I need more CPU because I don't need now. I need it now, but there will be new application that I need more power, and the material has to be resistant, which means that I can't just take cheap plastic. I need to take very good recycled plastic.
Yeah.
And this is a shift, and we are doing the shift guarantee, because again, as a CEO of any of our countries, you just look at your P&L and CapEx spend and say, yeah, it's more expensive. So it's a different way to think about all that. But I think we're already doing this transformation.
Yeah, but that is an important part, because if you look at, we are always trying to not get the cheapest, but at the same time, we need to understand that each country has its own also level of capacity to acquire specific. Right. Even though we try to harmonize this also from the central side, nevertheless, you need to respect that there are these challenges depending on the countries where we are. So one of the things where we do not really let down is the sustainability part. So we have a program we call Green Magenta, in which we go through exactly the different process of certification to guarantee that end-to-end, as it was mentioned already, that the whole process is respecting our specifications. And this goes from factory audits, because it does not only start with us, right? We set the guidelines, we set the rules, but we need to ensure that even our partners and the people we work with, that they're following these guidelines. Otherwise, we're just sharing a message that no one respects it. So it really starts from each one of us, also individuals, to make sure that this is being respected, this is being followed. Again, take into account also that this has an impact on the pricing side. And this is also our responsibility to explain to the customers and also to the markets that yes, this might come a bit more expensive, but there is a potential also important part for us, which is respecting the environment and making sure that there is sustainability on it. So,
yeah.
I mean, just to have the ARPU of some countries where you have operations versus some other countries where you have operations. Things start getting quite clear quite fast, right?
And that is exactly the challenge, right? So we'll not put the comparison, but the example. You have a Czech presence, but they have German presence, right? You can understand the difference between the two countries. So we need to respect all of them. We need to respect this difference. And we need to make sure that also these guidelines, that the markets understand. We're not expecting that the markets will spend millions of money on it. But again, it's our responsibility to support.
In that respect, we also have a check, which is the level of maturity of our customers are different from one country to the other. I mean, everybody would tell you, yes, spread, blah, 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 but when it comes to paying,
yeah,
suddenly a lot of people are not there. So we see a big challenge for us also, because again, the level of maturity, depending on the country, is not always the same.
We only have a few minutes left. I just got away from the organizers. Let's finish up with, so you have innovations you want to do. You have sustainability you want to put into your companies. There's always new software hardware and new models. It comes back to how do you monetize this? And again, it comes back to the consumers that or in the end has to or not have to pay. I mean, where does this? There's also very different models for this as well, right? So where do you stand on monetization of all these innovations?
We don't.
You don't.
Period. So it's included in the packages. And we
you don't bother your consumers
no, no, no.
with it.
I mean,
yeah.
What's the point? You know,
yeah.
you can offer parental control as a 1 euro per month package, nobody will opt in, right? You can put it in the package and nobody will opt out, right?
Okay.
And ultimately, it's the customer satisfaction.
But do you have different packages or is it just
it's
one?
It's included in one.
Okay.
But we do have different packages, it is included in all of them. But what I wanted to say is, you know, ultimately, yes, you can look at a certain feature as a revenue generator or revenue driver, or you can look at it as a churn prevention driver or customer satisfaction right, issue. So we opted to look at this from this point.
Our philosophy is slightly different. We monetize the services. We try to monetize the services internally, for example, our management say is that even the employee will pay for the services, special price, very good price, but still paid to understand what is the cost of the service. So we monetize CPE. If there is a security features, we monetize that. I use especially checks, understand that very good monetary system for that. So I explain the basic security for months is something like 1 year. Do you want that? Pay that to be at least secure on the basic level, go for that.
I'm sure part of your
business. And this is the price which everyone should consider if he wants to pay or not, but the service has a certain value and we monetize that on one side as well on the second side as a certain promise that it will give certain level of service to customer. And we measure mainly by the customer experience management really, how customers are satisfied with that. For the security especially, what do you like? It's assurance.
So it is by the package you add a euro extra or small extra fee or
exactly.
Monthly fee and that's
exactly.
The
simple way, just click services provided, not complicated setup like for the B2B customers where there is more customization, etc. But for the end customer really simple click, it works for the fixed services, it works for the mobile services and we pay for
separate services.
Yeah, the way I see it is the reality is the SLA up until now or recent times, let's say, is up to the ONT. So the CSP provides up to the ONT and then I say, Mr. Customer, in the house, you do what you can, that we used to be. But I think it's becoming obvious, especially for tier 1 operators, that the SLA move into the house and I would say into the bedroom. So that means that if you really think when people call the NOC, the support centers, my internet is not working, my Wi-Fi is not working, and more often than not, it's something related to the house. So I think that that something needs to be adopted, let's say, is to really change that mindset where the operator embrace that problem and turn it into an opportunity. Because I see a lot of greenfields, you know, when you look at, I think yesterday there was a presentation about fiber rollout, depending on the country, certain countries are already there and they have big penetration, but there are many others like the UK. Great opportunities for newcomers, and those ones would actually come with these kind of new innovative services, with that service coming into the SLA, into the house, into the bedroom. And Germany very similar, you know, you have a lot of fiber.
So you say develop a service package and make it a profit center rather than a loss center,
exactly.
And
exactly.
Do more instead of less.
Exactly, you cannot just say either it's not my problem or I give you all this but I don't charge you anything. It's an education process. I think the consumer is not used to pay for Wi-Fi. They are happy to pay for Netflix, they are happy to pay for other services, but when you say you need to pay for this extra, you know, quality Wi-Fi, why? You know, you're actually going to
want to have somebody come to round to your house and have some FDK, you have to pay 80 euros just for them to turn up. That's before they even start doing any work. So there's definitely some profit there as well. Yeah, go ahead, Jim, and then you, and then we'll wrap it up. Yeah.
Well, I think first we have to make the basics work. That's really the game. And then we can try to monetize services on top. But you know, that's not obvious. Security is a good example. I can ask, you know, everybody knows that there are security issues with your laptops. How many of you are paying on a private basis for an antivirus? I'm pretty sure that, and we have obviously an educated audience, most of us are not paying for a virus, an antivirus. So you get into this kind of also of...
we should all have a VPN, but we don't
need
that.
So that's not easy to monetize, but maybe there is a different way to think about it, which is using our CPEs and the technologies that are in the CPEs and in the that we control to work in a kind of B2B2C approach. Typically, we have assets, and maybe third parties that are providing the services would like to use these assets because this is going to help them have a more successful business. If I was mentioning Wi-Fi sensing, if I can provide this information about if there's someone or no one in the room, maybe a service provider is very interested in this information, and then I can monetize it. Actually, with our friend at DT and some others, we launched an initiative called Network APIs, which is typically to offer APIs to third parties to help them monetize them, and then maybe you can think about the different business models.
That's
a different way to think about it.
Monetize via
another
business.
If there is anyone in this audience that has a magic rule to make money with this, let us know. We're very interested to hear. The reality is that monetization is a very challenging thing. So we do have service like security, and like Shem said, antivirus is becoming very challenging for you to sell antivirus. Reality is that if you look at the clients that you use nowadays, most of the devices already come with an antivirus for free. So do you want to sell on top of it? Yeah, a bit challenged. Then you sell security service. What does it mean? Your package is not secure enough? So how can you explain this to the customers? So there are different challenges that we have here. It also depends case by case, because each country then has different rules. We have sales model, we have rental models, and if you look at it, the challenge across the different globes, we have again other variables that you need to take into account. Like Shem said, I think that we're trying to find the right approach. I think that giving the openness also to the partners, to the suppliers, to contribute to it and to work together with us to find these synergies is the right way. But there is no magic rule so far that we have found to make it work. So.
All right, and we have to wrap it up here. I mean, following up what Cem said, realize that we were all at home for a year and a half, and our societies kept working, and our industries kept working. That's this.